Welcome to Central United Methodist Church on this blessed Sunday morning. May God richly bless you.
Therefore, my beloved, shun the worship of idols. I speak as to sensible men. Judge for yourselves what I say. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Consider the people of Israel. Are not those who eat the sacrifices partners in the altar? What do I imply then? That food offered to idols is anything, or that an idol is anything? No. I imply that what pagans sacrifice, they offer to demons and not to God. I do not want you to be partners with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and the table of demons. Shall we provoke the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than He?
Sharing of our joys and concerns, we continue to lift up all those in our community, our country, and the world who are being impacted by the coronavirus. We pray for God's support and protection of all the doctors, nurses, policemen, firemen, and other emergency workers who must work in the midst of this deadly virus. Join me in our opening prayer. Lord God, you who created us and redeemed us and sustain us, we rejoice that you have chosen us to be your own and that you visit us and dwell with us and open to us the ways to abundant life. We are full of awe and wonder at what you have done and what you continue to do. By your word, the heavens and the earth were made. By the bounty of your mercy in Jesus Christ, we have been born to new life. Your Spirit fills the whole world with your loving kindness and gives us the power we need to be your witness and to lift up your holy name. Blessed are you, O God, and blessed are all who live in you. Help us today to joyfully proclaim our faith and to worship you as you desire. Bring us closer to you and to one another, and in our prayers and our thanksgiving, our hearing and our speaking, and our giving and receiving, make us more completely thine. We ask it in the name of Jesus, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen.
Today is Worldwide Communion Sunday. Churches all over the world will be breaking the bread and sharing the cup of Christ. The basic meaning of it all, God is love. That's it. That's the message that God is seeking so desperately to communicate to your heart and mine. We are loved. The writer of John puts it this way. In this is love, not that we love God, but that God loved us and gave his Son to be the expiation for our sin, but not ours only, but also the sin of the whole world, as 1 John 4:10 tells us. Take the body and blood of Jesus Christ this day, feed on him in your heart, and know that the meaning of it all is that you are loved and that your life matters. Praise be to God. Amen.
On the first Sunday in October, United Methodist congregations join many Christian churches across the globe in celebrating World Communion Sunday. World Communion Sunday began at Shadyside Presbyterian Church in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania in 1933. The Reverend Hugh Thompson Kerr and his congregation sought to demonstrate the interconnectedness of Christian churches regardless of denomination. Reverend Kerr appropriately chose the sacrament of Holy Communion to symbolize this unity. In 1940, the Federal Council of Churches of Christ in America, which included all of the predecessor denominations of the United Methodist Church, adopted Worldwide Communion Sunday. United Methodists believe in an open table. Anyone may receive communion. Our Book of Worship says, all who intend to lead a Christian life, together with their children, are invited to receive the bread and cup.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy,
holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night which he gave himself up to you, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, drink, this is my blood, which has been shed for you. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be with us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, with the confidence of children, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
body of Christ broken for you. Take, eat. The blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink. Our scripture lesson is from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 14 through 22. Hear the word of the Lord. Therefore, my dear friends, flee from the worship of idols. I speak as to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. The cup of blessings that we bless, is it not a sharing of the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Consider the people of Israel are not those who eat the sacrifices partners in the altar. What do I imply who eat the sacrifice? What do I imply then? That food sacrifices to idols is anything, or that an idol is anything? No, I imply that these pagan sacrifices, they sacrifice to demons and not to God. I do not want you to be partners with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of the demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and table of demons. Or are we provoking the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than he? The reading of God's word for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Bow with me. Gracious and loving God, as we come before you with the whole wide world in World Communion Sunday this day, we ask, Father God, that these words that we are about to hear are your words and not mine, and we can take these words with us and to be able to be in service and love to you. In Jesus' most precious and loving name we pray. Amen. At a recent national convention, sociologists came to an interesting conclusion that I think you will find fascinating. They said most of the problems, the troubles, the anxieties, and the turmoil that plague our society today are due to what? Now, this is not an assembly of Christians. These are secular sociologists meeting in a national convention. And they said most of the turmoil, troubles, anxieties, and problems that plague our society are due to the lack of communion. They didn't say communication, because surely we have an abundance of that. In fact, there has been more communication in this generation than probably all of the preceding generations combined. This is the age of communication. No, not a lack of communication, but a lack of communion. Communication is the transfer of ideas and facts, but communion is something much deeper. It is a mutual sharing of values and emotional feelings and the deepest purpose of our lives. And this we have too little in our society. The lack of communion found in the home, in the school, in society, in the church, is what is causing many people to revert to deviant behaviors, resulting in so many of today's problems. Today is Worldwide Communion Sunday. This special day was conceived many years ago as a way to get the divided Christian community to come together to have a greater unity by experiencing communion. It was an attempt to get the Christian community to focus on what united them rather than what divided them. If we could symbolically sit at one table rather than many tables, perhaps we could have a greater impact and witness to a divided world. Protestant churches all over this nation and the globe, regardless of their theological persuasion or their geographical location, will be assembling this morning to partake of the elements of this most sacred meal. From New York City to New Mexico, from Chicago to China, from Kansas City to Korea, from Beaver Falls to Belize, Christian disciples will gather in various church settings to be nurtured by the hope and love which are manifested in this Holy Supper. People of all races and classes within all kinds of hopes and dreams, from all types of philosophies and perspectives, will eat and drink of the loaf and cup to proclaim this day that those words read from the first epistle to the Church of Corinth are in fact quite literally true. However, as we gather today, even a quick scan of the news demonstrates that there is little communion in the world, and at times even less in the church. We have foolishly and vainly tried to run the world with solely human words, human efforts, and human hands. The words of God teaches us we must shift to the higher holy hands of God if unity and peace are to become a reality. Human hands and efforts are needed, but can only be elevated to higher ground by faith in God's decisive salvation in Jesus Christ. Like the woman portrayed in Luke 13, verses 10 through 13, as being crippled and bent over and not reaching her full potential, the Church of Jesus Christ is also crippled and bent over and not in prayer, because we so often solely rely on human hands and human thoughts. In June of 1991, Dr. Fred Craddock shared, "It has been said that there are two tables in any fellowship of believers. I thought if there were not two tables but one, then the one table would have to be the longest table in the world." What is true of the world as portrayed on news is as equally true in the Church of Jesus Christ. Protestants and Catholic Christians are fighting in Ireland, all in the name of Jesus Christ, who is the Prince of Peace. We see how divided the church is in South Africa by the evil institution of apartheid, with the opposition of communion. Instead of one table, it has two tables. One of the great needs of our local church is for a greater bonding together and deepening of our Christian fellowship. As the old hymn declares, "Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love." There's always need to be constant, intentional effort to strengthen the ties that bind us as a church family. It's easy to have two tables rather than one. I believe one of the greatest threats to the Christian community in the 20th century is what is probably called a fierce individualism that prevents any unity of purpose in a local church setting. This is also true of the world at large. It seems we are each so very different and unique. We all tend to go our own ways. We're so busy with our own agendas, family and work, and social gatherings and occasions. The problem is that it is in our busyness with our individual lives, we're isolated from one another. It's so easy for our church to become a private chapel rather than the body of Christ at work in the world. One of the fondest memories I have growing up is that of the Thanksgiving meal. I'm sure many of you share that as well. It was a Kodak moment when the entire family gathered around one table in the dining room. As the family grew in numbers through marriage, more leaves had to be added to the table. I remember one Thanksgiving day, because of the size of the gathering, it was proposed to have two tables, one for the adults and one for the children, up to age 12. As we ate dinner, something was missing. It was decided never to have two tables again. Dr. Craddock was right. When you gather together as a church or a family unit, if you have two tables, you don't have the full portrait of the church or the family. The only option is to make the table longer for all to be able to sit and be nurtured and strengthened from the food on the table. When we were all sitting at the one table, there was great laughter, good conversation, smiling faces, delightful communion. As we shared the past years of our lives together, God's family was complete. I strongly believe when someone is not allowed to come to this table, then someone is missing from God's billfold and family. It is my conviction that nothing would please our Heavenly Father more than to have all his sons and daughters gathered around one table rather than many tables we so tragically gather around divided. God is willing to help us. All we need is the boldness to ask for the power to do so. It won't come from our puny powers or purposes. The Bible tells us the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Perhaps one of the reasons we have fewer laborers is because of the division in the Christian community. In John 17, 21, Jesus prays that they all may be one. The guard of racism, sexism, classism, nationalism tells us that God is too busy to hear our request. However, I have it on good authority that God's greatest concern is that there only be one table for his family. This is our greatest need. It seems that even a group of secular sociologists at a national convention realize this dilemma. The questions before the House today, does the church realize it? If I read the Bible correctly, it was God who gave this vision to the church a long time ago. That is exactly why this meal is so important. It calls us to confess our broken relationships with one another, as well as the broken dreams and shattered hopes deep inside each of our own lives. As we eat from the loaf and drink from the cup, we will be redeemed by remembering we can never experience any brokenness that Christ has not already known. Only kneeling around this table with our eyes fixed on Christ will we ever be able to hold hands and see clearly for the first time, eye to eye. When this happens, we will have communion because there's room for all at the longest table in the world. Is this not a vision worth keeping alive? Is it not worth aiming for? In the words of C.S. Lewis, aim at heaven and you will get earth thrown in. Aim at earth and you will get either. Will we take the hand of Christ and allow him to bring us all to the one table he has prepared for the human family. It is my privilege to invite everyone today to the longest table in the world. The songwriter John Oxenham expresses it best. In Christ there is no east or west, in him no south or north, but one great fellowship of love throughout the whole wide earth. In him shall true hearts everywhere their high communion find. His service is the gold cord, close-minding all mankind. Praise be to God. Amen.
Now is the time where we will receive our tithes and offerings of love. Reminder that church expenses like utilities and salaries continue each week, even when we can't meet together for worship. There are three ways to give. You can mail your checks with your offering envelope. You can drop your offering envelope through the mail slot in the 13th Street ramp door, or you can contribute by clicking on the donate button on our website, www.centralunitedmethodistchurch.org. In the power of the Holy Spirit, we now go forth into the world to fulfill our calling as the people of God, the body of Christ. Prepare with me for the benediction. May God's creative spirit be with us in our hearts and minds as we leave this place. May God's creative spirit help us to see with new wonder the splendor of your creation all around us and inspire us to preserve and protect it. Go now in peace, love, and care for one another in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.